Well, good afternoon, good morning for some who are still in jet lag. We've already discussed the Middle East twice. Yesterday, with His Royal Highness Prince Turki Al-Faisal, and at lunch, with the debate between Joe Nye and Richard Haass. But we are returning to it this afternoon because of its, I would say, tragic centrality. If there were three words that characterize the new Middle East, I would say they are the following: fragmentation, with the risk of territorial explosion, which are already taking place in front of our eyes; radicalization, with its particularly sad religious connotation, spreading all over, and starting in Jerusalem, one would say, in symbolic terms. And probably the third term would be the expansion in geographic terms, as if the Middle East was no longer a geographic expression, but nearly a state of mind or an emotional reality, with young people from Europe to the United States converting to a certain radical vision of Islam, joining the fight in the Middle East under the impression that to kill means to exist, to become a martyr gives them a sense of identity. Beyond those three words, it seems to me that there are three key questions with which we should be dealing with. The first one is clearly, how do you contain, repel, eventually destroy what I will call from now on Fahesh, which an expression which I like very much, all the more so that I don't know exactly what it means, but it sounds well. And it serves a clear purpose to delegitimize this challenge of an awful nature. Within the issue of fighting Fahesh, there is a subtopic, which is, what do we do in Syria? There seems to be a consensus, at least in London and Washington, that family change is the right alternative to regime change. But is that realistic, given the competitive ambivalence on the subject of Syria of so many countries? One in particular, which is not represented in this panel, Turkey. What is the priority of Turkey? To fight Fahesh or to contain Kurdish nationalism? And during the time of the siege of Kobani, we could have hesitation on the topic. The second key subject, of course, is the Middle East core conflict, the Israeli-Palestinian problem. When we speak of a two-state solution, are we paying lip service to an ideal? Are we really striving for an achievable goal? Or is it too late, given the radicalization of internal politics on both sides? given Hamas, given the movement to the right of Israeli politics, given also the weakness of American pressures and influence, in particular on that topic. The third question, of course, is the issue of Iran. Have we overestimated the political influence of the moderate? Have we been, again, in a field of illusion? I think looking at the Middle East, and in particular at the Arab-Israeli conflict, we can have two approaches. One would be following a Jewish tradition, a word called Tikkun Olam, which means to repair the world. The world has been broken. It is our responsibility to repair it. And there's no place better to start repairing it than in the Middle East. But there's also another tradition, which is to look at it as a Greek drama, a Greek tragedy, where the gods have decided to punish the man for their impudence and arrogance. And in fact, we are always hesitating between these two approaches, the wish to act upon the reality or the despair leading to cynicism and passivity. Well, to deal with those issues of the Middle East today, we have five excellent speakers representing different approaches and positions. The first one will address us in French, and it is Hubert Védrine, former French foreign minister and one of the best analysts of world politics. Hubert, it's all yours.
Thank you. So I will speak in French. Everybody has a its machine. Je vais faire sept observations, mais qui sont toutes brèves.
En 8 minutes.
Voilà. Premièrement, c'est pas parce que nous sommes devant une situation terrible qu'il faut oublier les turbulences et les problèmes au Moyen-Orient depuis 50 ans, 70 ans, voire même depuis un siècle. Donc ne raisonnons pas ici comme si brusquement il y avait des problèmes extrêmement graves dans un Moyen-Orient paisible. Ce n'est pas le cas. Il faut garder la vision historique. Deuxièmement, il faut avoir en tête une toile de fond, à mon avis, interne à l'islam. D'abord, ce qui me semble être une lutte historique en une toute petite minorité fondamentaliste, extrémiste, et une toute petite minorité moderniste pour l'influence décisive. Ça colore tout. Et en plus, ce que tout le monde a à l'esprit maintenant, et qui s'est réveillé, c'est-à-dire l'antagonisme sunnite-chiite, qui s'est réveillé parce qu'il y a eu des processus de désagrégation. Mais c'est quand même un élément de toile de fond qui est très important et qui aggrave chacune des autres questions. Troisièmement, nous assistons à un processus schumpeterien, Schumpeter, de destruction créatrice. Enfin, on peut espérer que c'est créateur, mais nous assistons plutôt à la phase de destruction. C'est spectaculaire dans le cas de la Syrie, qui est une sorte de caricature tragique de ce que l'on a appelé les printemps arabes, avec beaucoup de naïveté. Mais c'est également le cas dans la situation de l'Irak, avec un processus qui remonte au moins à 2003, peut-être aussi aux erreurs de Saddam Hussein avant. Donc ce sont ces deux cas particuliers qui créent la désagrégation de structures étatiques anciennes, dont on sait qu'elles remontent à la fin de l'Empire ottoman, et notamment à Sykes-Picot, qui créent le terrain, la disponibilité sur lequel Daesh s'est développé. Mais ça n'aurait pas eu lieu s'il n'y avait pas eu une série d'erreurs accumulées qui ont fourni des troupes pour ce mouvement. Après, il y a la particularité que c'est un mouvement terroriste qui veut se sédentariser. Donc là, on entre dans un autre scénario. Donc on a un cadre de destruction dont peut-être il sortira quelque chose, on ne sait pas encore quoi. Et l'élément kurde, tu as parlé du Kurdistan, l'élément kurde, jusqu'où va aller pour les Kurdes l'opportunité? Autonomie, oui. Si les Kurdes sont entraînés par cette conjoncture jusqu'à l'idée d'indépendance, évidemment, ils vont recréer une coalition contre eux. Est-ce qu'ils pourront garder la maîtrise de ça? Quatrièmement, il y a d'énormes incertitudes stratégiques qui s'ajoutent à ça. La première, à mon avis, elle est dans la politique américaine. Que va devenir la politique américaine dans cette région et sur chacun des sujets? Bien sûr, on pense à l'Iran. À mon avis, c'est très différent selon qu'il y a finalement un accord avec l'Iran ou non. S'il n'y a pas d'accord avec l'Iran, la situation n'est pas neutre, puisque les différents acteurs vont tirer des leçons de l'absence d'accord. Et il peut y avoir des réactions à ça. S'il y a un accord avec l'Iran, c'est une redistribution des cartes considérable qui va aller assez vite, à mon avis, après. Et évidemment, ça pose des questions aux autres partenaires essentiels du jeu, à commencer par l'Arabie saoudite. C'est très important de savoir comment l'Arabie anticipe l'éventuel accord et la dynamique qui en découle pour gérer ça. Il y a d'autres incertitudes stratégiques. La première que tu as mentionnée aussi, c'est celle dans la politique turque, qui a au moins un double jeu, peut-être un triple jeu. En réalité, on voit bien que sa vraie priorité, c'est d'empêcher le Kurdistan, indépendant et large, mais il y a d'autres objectifs qui s'ajoutent et qui contredisent. Une autre incertitude stratégique, c'est l'évolution en Israël. La dynamique interne en politique intérieure israélienne, surtout tant qu'il y a ce mode de scrutin en Israël, est-ce que ça va aller jusqu'à fermer finalement toute hypothèse de solution, quelle qu'elle soit ou non? Que devient Israël dans ce contexte? J'ajouterai une question, c'est est-ce qu'on peut imaginer, si l'affaire d'Ukraine était à un moment donné dépassée, est-ce qu'il y a une possibilité de retour d'un jeu russe sur la question iranienne, sur la question syrienne, sur la question kurde? C'est pas immédiat, c'est pas urgent, mais c'est dans le tableau. Cinquième remarque, peut-être la plus difficile, c'est l'impuissance des puissances. Parce qu'on peut parler politique américaine, on peut parler de tout ce qu'on veut, mais l'impuissance des puissances habituelles est frappante. Les puissances extérieures sont comme des vulcanologues qui analysent une éruption volcanique, qui analysent les cendres qui redescendent. Où sont les leviers? Où sont les leviers politiques, militaires, économiques? Où est la volonté d'intervenir? Est-ce que les puissances ont la capacité interne, en termes d'opinion publique et de système politique, d'intervenir dans des politiques durables? La question se pose de plus en plus, en tout cas pour les démocraties. Tocqueville avait raison. C'est de plus en plus difficile pour les démocraties d'avoir une politique intérieure. Enfin, pardon, excusez-moi, d'avoir une politique extérieure à partir du moment où elles sont conditionnées par la politique intérieure. Quant à l'Union européenne, je n'en parle même pas. Sixième remarque, à partir de là, il y a des vrais risques. Il y a des vrais risques d'enchaînement, d'engrenage, qui ne sont entièrement contrôlés par personne. Quand on prend la question de Daesh, on voit que Daesh peut être endigué par des actions militaires diverses, mais pas éradiqué. Si la coalition voulait vraiment éradiquer, il faudrait qu'elle arrive à imposer en Syrie et en Irak une solution politique crédible et durable. Mais à ce moment, on se heurte à des contradictions complètes. Qu'est-ce qu'on fait avec l'Iran? Jusqu'où? Qu'est-ce qu'on fait par rapport au régime syrien? Ça, c'est le plus frappant. On voit les limites d'une action extérieure encore plus nettement sur ce point. Septième remarque, et j'en aurai fini, puisque c'est pour commencer, tout le forum créé par Thierry de Montbrial tourne autour de l'idée de meilleure gouvernance. Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire, meilleure gouvernance? Est-ce qu'on peut imaginer qu'on arrive à régler correctement l'accord avec l'Iran, que ne ce soit pas inquiétant pour les voisins, à remettre en marche une solution Proche-Orient? Tout ça paraît utopique. Plus la question sunnite-chiite. Est-ce qu'on peut rêver pour le Moyen-Orient un jour de l'équivalent de ce qu'avaient été les accords de Westphalie en Europe, grâce à Richelieu et Mazarin, je veux dire sous l'angle d'organiser la cohabitation entre des régimes politiques différents et des croyances religieuses différentes. Une cohabitation durable, fondée sur la non-ingérence. Est-ce que c'est concevable un jour? On voit bien que quand on essaie de raisonner en termes de meilleure gouvernance, ou alors en reprenant ta formule tycoon, on voit bien que l'objectif est très très lointain. Donc je pense qu'on va plutôt raisonner step by step sur tout ça.
Merci beaucoup. The second speaker is going to be Ribal Al-Assad, who is, among many other things, the chairman of the Iman Foundation. Please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mosi. And it's a great pleasure to be here amongst so many distinguished guests. Let me first start by saying that the situation we are in today, the problem that we are facing around the world, Europe, Russia, China, the United States, of having the greatest menace and the greatest threat to our national security, it's not something new. And actually, I found it a bit astonishing that some people said that it took us by surprise. It hasn't taken us by surprise because we have been, myself, I have warned for the past 3.5 years, our organization did, that if we continue on allowing our allies in the region to promote sectarian hatred and sectarian divide, this is what's going to happen. Unfortunately, in my country, for example, let's start saying about Syria, which led to actually this whole mess that we are in today. In Syria, we went on backing an opposition that was mainly Islamist in nature, without taking into regards that there are minorities in Syria. Everybody wanted change in Syria. Everybody wanted democratic change in Syria. Everybody wanted to live as we are living in Europe and in the Occident, in the West. But unfortunately, we did not want to go backward to Sharia law and such Islamist rhetoric that has been going on lately. In Iraq, same as in Syria, we have seen the rise of the Islamic State, which has started in 2006, but it has came to Syria because there was a certain atmosphere that allowed it to prosper, that allowed it to grow, because there was money coming in from certain country, there was support, there was television channels who were set up and purposely to encourage and to incite sectarian hatred, violence and killing. And we have been telling them, you have to shut them down if we want to see people all around the Middle East live in harmony, if we want to see genuine democracies taken on in the Middle East and beyond. Unfortunately, again, some of Syria's neighbors and other regional powers who are our allies, including Turkey, have not listened to that. Instead, they have incited, they have allowed foreign fighters to come into Syria. As Mr. Vice President Biden said lately, that our problem, our biggest problem in the region was our allies. Our allies who did not want to listen to the United States when they said, please stop supporting those extremist factions in the Middle East. And this is exactly what has led to where we are today. Today there is a coalition. Everybody is running around trying to find a solution to ISIS. And I think it's going to be very difficult because, first of all, we're not after a brand name. The Islamic State, is just a brand. We're after the underlying ideology, which is the ideology of those Islamist extremists who believe in killing all those who do not share their perverted ideology. This is not genuine Islam. And as His Majesty King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia said lately, that this is not the true Islam, that we have to promote the true Islam and to be against fitna, because fitna is the biggest sin in Islam. And unfortunately, nobody has listened. Unfortunately, the same countries, some of them, let's say, give an example about Kuwait, where the United States said that one of the Minister of Justice in Kuwait was backing al-Nusra, was funding al-Nusra. All what he was allowed to do, it was to resign. He was not brought to justice, and this is not going to make the situation better. If we are to stand for our values, we have to stand for our values everywhere. We have to stand firmly and strongly for our values. We have to support the values of human rights, democracy, and human rights everywhere if we want people to believe in the West's values, which are not actually Western values. They are universal values. And the problem today, we cannot lie or be hypocritical about it, because there are, as you know, satellite television, there are alternative media, and the people are able to see what's going on. They are able to see that there are, on one side, we are promoting democracy and freedom in one country, and on the other side, we are forgetting about, you know, other countries who are supposed to be our allies. So how could that happen? If we are to be for democracy and freedom, as I said, we have to be for it and fight for it everywhere. And on the question of Turkey yesterday, I heard His Royal Highness speaking about Turkey, and Turkey could have a solution. I don't think that Turkey could have a solution, because let me first speak as a Syrian and then as an Arab. As a Syrian, Turkey, as much as as Israel or Iran, are countries who are occupiers. For Syrians, we learned that in our school books, I mean in the curriculum, that Turkey occupies a great part of Syrian territory, which is much larger than the Golan Heights, actually. As same as Iran, who occupies Ahwaz and Israel, the Golan Heights. So there cannot be a difference between an occupier and another occupier. Not because one is from that religion or the other, an occupier is the same, and we have to treat them the same way. Also, Turkey, under Mr. Prime Minister, President Erdogan, has had a creeping policy of Islamization. They have backed, as we have seen, the Muslim Brotherhood. They have backed them in Egypt. They have backed them in Syria. And they have backed other factions, such as al-Nusra. And we lately saw in the town of Kobani that they found themselves in a very difficult situation. It was either they defend the Kurds, and they would find themselves into conflict with those, IS, Islamic State, or al-Nusra, and other groups, similar groups, which they have helped and supported to infiltrate into Syria. Or they would fight allow for the Islamic State to attack the Kurds, and they would have had problem with over 20 million Kurds in Turkey. And, we have seen that an attack came on the Kurds from Kobani, from inside Turkey, from the Islamic State, which shows again that Turkey has been backing strongly those Islamist groups, and Turkey needs to change. If these are our allies, they have to understand that the world has changed. If they are allies, they have to support our values. If they are allies, they cannot be sponsoring terrorism. This is the most important thing. How could you be my ally, or how could you differentiate between countries who sponsor terrorism when you talk about Iran and then you allow countries, for example, as Turkey? And as I told you, many people, including, as I said, Mr. Vice President Biden, and others, have pointed the finger at countries that are allies in the region who have been supporting terrorism. And unfortunately, if this does not change, we're going to find ourselves, as the former deputy head of the CIA said, Mr. Michael Morell, before he left a year ago. He said that today those Islamist groups in Syria, he said that not this August, the August before that, have become the greatest threat to our national security, greater than the threat of Iran and North Korea, which people should have understood in the region. That means we should start talking to Iran, because if they are greatest threat, it's not only those groups on the ground, it's who is behind them, who is backing them, who is supporting them, who is funding them, who is inciting on this religion, on this sectarian divide. Unfortunately, when we had someone like Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi, who incited last year on killing, he said, I'm calling on all Sunnis to go and kill Shias and Alawites in the Middle East, and all Sunnis who could carry an arm should go do that. Well, this is not exactly calling a democratic change in Syria or Iraq or any other country. And unfortunately, we have the Grand Mufti of Saudi Arabia who came out and welcomed Mr. Qaradawi's speech. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The third speaker is going to be Meir Shetrit, an old friend of the WPC, a seasoned and experienced Israeli political figure, member of the Knesset for a very long number of years, who has occupied many ministerial functions. Mayor Chetril.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm glad to be here, and I think the issue is very, very important and very interesting to listen to all my colleagues. Every one of them is an excellent possibility, really, to change views. Matter of fact, the Middle East is quite in chaos. We have many countries without any connection to Israel that are going apart. Syria, Libya, Iraq, Yemen. What's going on there? It's really unbelievable. One who follows what's going on in those countries. So I take Syria, for example, or any other places. There are a lot of terror organizations working over there, active over there. Everybody of them want peace, peace of Syria. There are in Syria alone almost more than 10 different organizations, including Ansar Beit al-Mikdash, Ansar Beit al-Mikdas, Al-Nusra, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Hezbollah. Everybody works for his own target, everybody his own plan about Syria, and Israel can do nothing except of opening a hospital on the border with Golan Heights and receive all those who have been injured in different, doesn't matter which side they came from, they can get treatment easy in this hospital, and those who are in bed injured are brought to Israel, to hospitals. We have in Israel today more than 300 families, 300 people from Syria are treated in the Israeli hospitals, and they bring the family coming with them, and they very, very wonder to find a different Israel than the image they had before. Yesterday to Prince Turki, we speak, and I like the way he spoke. I like his sincerity and his frankness. And he said yesterday that Iran is very involved in all the activity of all those terror organizations. And if somebody have to testify it, I can be very good testifying for that. Personally, Israel have a possibility in which Iran have two big arms, one in our north and one in our south, the Hezbollah in the north in Lebanon, and the Hamas in the south in Gaza, both financed, trained, armed by Iran, with a very, very heavy arming. Many times we stop ships which coming from Iran toward Gaza or other convoys of weapon which goes from Iran through Syria to Lebanon. It doesn't matter what the United Nations make decision over there. It doesn't matter UNIFIL. Hezbollah today have more than 100,000 different missiles, much more accurate, much more long range, much more heavy, threatening Israel. Same situation was in Gaza as well. So we are living in a very difficult neighborhood. And what's made me wonder is the fact that in this situation today, we find ourselves as Israelis fighting together with many of the radical of the Islam countries against the radical Islam. At last, many countries understood that Israel was standing alone in the front of fighting terror, and now we are fighting together against the radical Islam. You see, even Iran have some of its fight with the ISIS. But many other countries understand now that the terror is a threat, not only to Israel, but to each and every one of them. And in this situation, it was could be a very good opportunity to have arrangement or peace with all those Arab states if we didn't have the problem, which is the main obstacle, is the Palestinian Authority and Palestinian state. I disagree with my colleagues which spoke at lunch today, that they say it's impossible to come to a solution. I totally reject it. I believe that we have no other chance or no other choice but to come to a solution and to establish a Palestinian state alongside with Israel. Even Netanyahu saying it. Netanyahu today in his party is considered to be leftist. He said it in the Knesset many times, that he's for solution of two states to two people. The problem is that he's better talker than better doer. And I think that in the situation in which we are, we have no other alternative. And that's the reason why I personally believe that the only way to do it is through the Arab Initiative. And again, I come to the speech yesterday of Prince Turki, Al-Faisal. And I agree almost with every word he said about it. Why I support, and I support it not today. Today it's a retrospective, it's not a big wisdom. I support it from the first day it came to the world, 2002. I tried that time to convince Ariel Sharon to give up the disengagement from Gaza and call Riyadh and ask tell them, we accept your initiative, let's talk about it. And I was very glad to hear Prince Turki spoke on the last year in Monaco and yesterday again, that he said we are open to talk, we're willing to talk. And really, I think Saudi, which made this initiative, came with a very, in my opinion, genius way how to solve the problem. They're not offering only a peace with Palestinians. They say, if you go back to 67 borders with a swap, I said that, in my opinion, there was no Arab leader in the Arab League which believes that Israel can go literally to 67 borders. But all of them, in my opinion, will agree to swap. I said it in 2002, and I'm glad that it became true. And the second thing, they said, you find the agreeable, justified solution to the Palestinian refugees. I'm quoting from the Arab Initiative. And agreeable means that Israel had to agree. Which means, I don't believe that there is any Arab leader which believes that Israel will accept Arab refugees or Palestinian refugees into the green line of Israel. But we have no problem they will come to live in the Palestinian states if they want to and be compensated. So, and why I'm supportive so much with the Arab Initiative, why I think it's the best solution. Because why to make peace? Why to pay the same price anyway, just for peace with Palestinians, if we can have with the same price, peace with 57 Islam countries and full normalization, and that will be the end of the conflict. Again, I'm quoting from the Arab Initiative. Secondly, this is the only way to guarantee the existence of that peace. Because if we have a peace and normalization with all the Islam and Arabic state, who will break it? Nobody will break it in that situation. That's also the way to bring the Hamas again under the authority of the Palestinian Authority. Why? Because they cannot stay alone. If they stay alone and don't give a damn about all the Arab countries and Islam countries, we will treat them like an enemy. So from all those reasons, this is the best way to go. And I believe that it could be done only if Prime Minister of Israel will raise the glove and call Riyadh and say, let's talk about this initiative. That's what I believe. That's what I would do. And I believe that we can arrive to peace with all the Arab states within a year, 1 year, if there is a will. I'm sorry to say that our partners are not easy partners. Palestinians never miss an opportunity to miss an opportunity. Arafat missed the opportunity with Barack and Clinton. Abu Mazen missed the opportunity with Olmert, which signed an agreement with him. He asked for a few days, he never came back. I'm going to finish, just one more minute. That's a citizen of the area. and they're also creating a very big obstacles on the way. Sometimes I have the feeling that maybe the Palestinians don't want really to be a state. For them, it's the best situation. They don't have to bear the responsibility going in the state. Today, they are in the center of the eye of the world. We are considered to be the bad guys. Even it's not true. It's not the situation, really. Palestinians living very well under the authority of Israel. And all the rumors are not really rumors. And I listened yesterday to Prince Talal, who said that the Minister of Housing in Washington said that maybe we don't need our Palestinian state, maybe we should annex the area. You know, he represents in the maximum 3 members of the Knesset. He's the very, very right wing of the political rainbow in Israel. It's like the Hamas say he wants to wipe Israel. Iran say they want to wipe Israel. We have no intention to go anywhere. We are there to stay. And the Palestinians are there to stay. I believe that these talks should be done between us and the Arab world.
Thank you very much.
It should be done, one more minute, I'm sorry. It could be done. It should be done on personal level, on the way that we understand, we have to understand the Arab culture. The Arab, we have to do it with respect. We have to create trust between the sides. Otherwise, we arrive nowhere. And I'm sorry to say that Americans, which taking the responsibility to mediate between Israel and Palestinians, understand nothing in Arabs. They're doing all the possible mistakes everywhere, and sometimes creating damages. The last agreement with John Kerry, he was talking one way to the Palestinians and another way to the Israelis without talking to each other. I asked in the Knesset, how can you make peace with someone you don't meet? Netanyahu never met Abu Mazen during all the process. I don't believe it's possible to make peace with anyone without meeting him. I believe that to make peace with someone, I have to know him very easy, very warmly, very close. And that could be done in our area. Therefore, I believe that Israel should negotiate by itself and invite the United States and Russia and Europe to be participate and support the process. But we should do it ourselves, and I believe that could be done. Now, last but not least, we are in election now because of that reason. Netanyahu decided to spread up the Knesset. We're going to election, and we are trying now to create a front of central left parties in order to replace this right-wing government. If that will happen, it will be a total change in the attitude, and I hope it will happen. Thank you.
Thank you. The fourth speaker is Sergei Karaganov, honorary chairman of the Presidium of the Non-Governmental Council on Foreign and Defense Policy of Russia, and a very old friend of mine. Sergei, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. First of all, Russians are known to be brutal and straightforward.
And short.
Yes, and I must say that everybody and sincere. And that means that nobody has said that before, but I want to start with words of admiration towards Teddy. He manages it again. It's impossible, but he is managing it again. Thank you. Now I'm going back to the subject, and the subject is, I look at it from a different angle. About 13 years ago, a group of eminent former senior intelligence officers came to my office, and it happened after NATO started a land invasion into Afghanistan. Most of them were Afghan veterans. And I said, they told me, Professor Karaganov or Sergei, could you please explain why? Are they preparing a foothold to attack Iran? That's the only explanation. I brought them to the map, of course, and I saw that it's impossible to attack Iran from Afghanistan. And I tried to explain them that it was simply incompetence. And I must say that looking at the policy of my country and the policy of of most of the Western countries towards that era during all these years, I must say that we have contributed to the deterioration of the situation immensely. It was a combination of impotent incompetence or incompetent impotence. So when communists went there, well, let's put it this way. The situation is much worse than it was 100 years ago when the Muslim empire collapsed. Then for the time being, it was divided into sub-colonies, and then everybody started to compete with everybody. Americans threw away Brits and the French. Whether the situation got better or not. Then Russia, Soviets ran in, and of course, they started to compete with everybody else, propping up their so-called allies and imposing their socialist, or our, whatever they were, not mine, a communist and socialist ideas on the population. Of course, it backfired immensely. It was absolutely masochist policy towards former Soviet Union because, the more we imposed socialism on them, the more money they demanded from us. But finally, we collapsed also because, by the way, Soviet Union was the biggest donor of aid, including to the countries of the Middle East. It was the biggest aid donor in the world. And now we're having the same kind of policies which are being conducted by our Western friends and colleagues. When countries are seriously imposing or trying to impose democracy, it's again a masochism. The more democratic these countries are, the more anti-Western they are. It's obvious. We have to acknowledge that this group of countries or this area is going through a difficult civilizational process which implies at this juncture a deterioration. And we have to deal with it with open eyes. So what could we do? We should not interfere. Be with the democracy or with the rule of law or with everything. Let people of this huge area decide for themselves, develop. What could be my direct advice? Even at a panel like here, we are advising ourselves how to interfere. I mean, the more we interfere, the worse it is for the peoples of this area. So what could be done? Stop exporting democracy or socialism or whatever. Stop ostracizing Iraq. Israel. It is the only beacon of stability there, and we see more and more of ostracizing of Israel. I mean, I'm not too sweet, because the other part of it, I mean, the other beacon of stability in that area, which we should at least not undermine, is of course Iran. It is the most civilized and the most sophisticated country in the area. Instead of that, we have been for almost 30 years undermining Iran, which could have been, by the way, the island of stability in the area. What could we, positive advice of what could be done, go to Russians. We did achieve two operations which were largely successful in an area like that. But it was Tajikistan and Chechnya. But it was very on the margins, and it is only Russians which could do that, because we are able to sacrifice indiscriminately our lives and treasure. Other than that, do not interfere. So help where you can, mostly in humanitarian ways. Close borders to terrorists. Help those areas with developmental aid which are close to your borders, and I'm talking now to Europeans, so to curtail immigration. Suppress the negative elements in your own societies. Or else, they will suppress you. And I'm speaking about the growing radicalization of the immigration which you have committed. Then wait, and maybe in 50 years, things will get better. But if we continue to involve ourselves with incompetence, we are sure to make things worse. The only thing we could do useful, there are several things. One is educate these people, some of these people. So because the more there are well-educated people there, the better it is, especially with the higher education. And then understand that we are unable to do much. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sergei. Last but not least, Miguel Angel Moratinos, former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Spain. If there is peace one day in the Middle East, historians will pay tribute to a man who worked passionately for the cause of peace in the last decade. Miguel.
Thank you, Dominique. Historian will pay tribute if we succeed, no? But unfortunately...
If there is peace, that's what I said.
We are full of frustration, no? So thank you for Thierry and organizers to give us the opportunity to continue to debate the Middle East issue. I think Ambassador Wu, the Chinese ambassador yesterday, started his intervention saying there was four main issues in the global governance, and the first one was the Middle East. And when we are trying to really identify the new reality of the Middle East in this kind of new global world, that we use new words like global, smart, green, we are becoming familiar. There are two concepts that have to be applied to the Middle East, that is complexity and uncertainty. And that makes me think about the famous quotation of President Charles de Gaulle when he started his visit to the Middle East. He said, "Je pars au levant complexe avec des idées simples." And what is going on is that we are trying to solve the Middle East with simple ideas. Maybe we have to come with complex ideas. So I have not so much time, but... I think the Middle East deserves all this time because it's the quintessence of the new challenging world, where all traditional security concerns, territorial, military intervention, oil, energy, trade, converge to the new challenge of today's world, that is global terrorism, food security, water scarcity, cultural divide, and that's what we are so much engaged, what we are so much preoccupied, what is going on. So my second reflection is that what to do? Well, this kind of international fatigue. Everybody is fed up about the Middle East, and everybody is more fed up about the Palestinian-Israel issue. No way. It's a kind of utopian. The ones who believe in future peace is because we are considered like idealists, no? People who can still try to make peace in this region. And we should answer, the partners, the parties, Arabs, Israelis, Iranian, Turkey, but the so-called West, the European and Americans, we should ask ourselves, what has to be done? Let's continue business as usual. That means what happened during the last 4 years, that what I can qualify is the drone diplomacy, is the drone military action, and in the Middle East, the drone diplomacy. Yes, Mr. Kerry tried his best with all methods and all approach, but there is no strategy. I don't think we have to interfere, my dear friend, but I think we should have a strategy. Can we ask what is the U.S. strategy in the Middle East? Maybe they have one. I have some doubts about the European strategy. Should we have a strategy not to be all the time in a defensive way? Starting with Syria, then later on we come with Thrash, then we come with how we are going to stabilize Iraq, all on the defensive. And the naughty guys, the worst of the worst, as Prince Faisal say, they are advancing. Look what was the Middle East 10 years ago or even 5 years ago. And how is today? Worst and worst. So, my dear friend, we have to do something. Not to interfere, but we have to do something in order to stop and to really try to make a better future for the region and for all of us. So I have two main proposals. Number one, as His Highness Prince Faisal say, number one priority, my dear mayor, Israeli-Palestinian issue. It's not because I've been involved in the Palestinian issue for many years. It's because it's the core heart of the stability of the Middle East. And one of the reasons of this stabilization of fanatism, of radicalism, is because the people in the region, they will not continue to accept this double standard and this sense of frustration of not having the two-state solution to be a reality. So how we are going to move for the two-state solution? Because we all agree about the two-state solution. It has been even approved in the Security Council. But my dear Israeli friend and my dear American friend and some Europeans are afraid to recognize the Palestinian state. They said we will recognize only after negotiation. My dear mayor, when Ben-Gurion, the 14th of May, 1948, had the courage, the vision, to decide to create the State of Israel and wrote a letter to the UN, you negotiate with Palestinians to have your state? So why we make the statehood of Palestinian a condition for negotiation? But that is the logical, but we are in the Middle East and everything is illogical. So okay, let's go to the illogical. Let's go to negotiate with Israel. But Israel has not been ready to negotiate the last years. So let the international community, at least the European Union, my dear Hubert, for once, take an initiative. And I think this movement of recognition of Palestinian state should be not just for the sake of recognition, have to be a diplomatic instrument, have to be an instrument that will mobilize the U.S. that could later on negotiate with the parties and the Europeans to push with the Arab Peace Initiative the double recognition process, as I call, to recognize Israel by the Islamic and Arab countries, and Israel and the Europeans and the Americans to recognize the Palestinian state. If we put a framework and we put a deadline, Madam Mayor, if you win the election, maybe that will not be necessary. But imagine that Netanyahu and his coalition won the election. What we are going to do? To say no more hope? No, we have to make some pressure. So we'll put in 2 years or 1 year and a half, if nothing happens, there is no serious negotiation. We, international community, have said two-state solution. We recognize the Palestinian state. Why not? It will be two entities negotiating the dispute, the differences at the level of state, not at level of an entity and an state. So that should be the first priority. The second,
and you
I'm
have
being
one
very
minute
short,
for your
yes,
second priority.
Is about Iran. I think has been a big misunderstanding about Iran. We all agree that it's our adversary, or whatever you want to do, with the one who are complicating our life. Well, in the most difficult time of the Cold War, the United States and the Soviet Union decide to engage. So my vision is that to be during the last 10 years trying to get only nuclear negotiation with Iran is a big mistake. Because in the meantime, you said, Mayor, we have Iran in Gaza, we have Iran in Lebanon, we have Iran in Iraq, we have Iran in France, we have Iran everywhere. So we don't get any commitment on nuclear ability, and we have Iran everywhere. So let's put some containment and some engagement with Iranian in a much broader sense. So I'm not saying that they should not continue negotiation on the nuclear issue, but only to focus on nuclear issue that will give Iran the capacity, as is happening, to expand their influence and their role in the whole region.
Thank you very much, Miguel. Well, food for thought. Let me start with the observation made by Hubert Védrine in his presentation. What is the meaning of better governance in the Middle East? 60 years ago, Egypt was on the eve of a revolution, but in a much better state than South Korea, which was coming out of a war. And the last 60 years, I've seen an extremely different transformation of Asia on the one end and of the Middle East on the other. There was miracle in Asia. There was, to say the least, no miracle in the Middle East. Why is it so? I think to a large extent, it is a question of governance. And not only of international context, not only of other consideration. The Arab Spring, whatever that means, was based on the frustration of some significant segment of the population towards not necessarily the inexistence of democracy, but the absence of the rule of law and the betrayal of what is called human right policies. So somewhere this is a question that has to be addressed. When you rightly denounced the radicalization, the fanaticism of Daesh, Faesh, there is also what is called state terror. It has been said yesterday by the prince that the majority of the 200,000 people that died in Syria had been killed by their own regime. I will not enter into figures, but this is part of the reality of the region, which we must face. So somewhere I would say that better governance in the Middle East means the same thing than better governance in Asia or better governance in Africa. I'm not calling for the imposition of Western democratic models onto the region, but I'm calling for the simple existence of what people describe as the rule of law, because I believe it's very important. Second point, because I want to challenge Sergei, I agree fully, maybe, with your vision that the last thing we should do is to interfere in the region. But I'm not sure Russia has applied that policy to itself. I see great involvement of Russia in the region for a very long period of time. So are you speaking as an intellectual denouncing your country as well as the rest? That's fine. I mean, you are an independent speaker, but it seems to me that it should be applied to your country as well as to the other. When it comes to Meir, I feel terribly close to what you say, but are you very representative of society? Yes. Of the political body? Not necessarily. And if you are, you have to prove by making an alliance of the moderate that you can make a difference. And unfortunately, the moderate in power did not necessarily make a difference in the past. You could say that, repeat that formula, the Palestinian never miss an opportunity to miss an opportunity. But I think the reality, to use the word of Miguel, is more complex than that simply. So I think we have a lot of question to raise if we want to be true to ourselves and to the audience. Sergei.
First of all, I mean, thank you. I applied it fully, to, of course, to my former country, Soviet Union. Russia is less involved now, but if we're involved, I will condemn it, of course. What I have been saying, and I will want to reiterate, and here I would disagree with you, Dominique, a little bit. You said it's about question of governance. I'm saying it's a question of culture. It's much deeper than governance. I think that... fantastic Muslim Arab civilization is living through a difficult period. European civilization lived through a difficult period from 6th to 11th, 12th centuries before producing fantastic results. Now we have the same happening to the Arab Muslim civilization, and if we interfere, it wouldn't help. It would only deteriorate things, because that would create, and that is creating, hatred towards the outside world and excuse for themselves not to do things. And I must say that the more we are aloof, the better it is for the people, because, of course, it wouldn't take six centuries, like in Europe, to recuperate this time, I hope. Thank you.
Mayor?
Yeah, I would like to answer to your question. I think first that we've been very close to agreement in the past. Therefore, I say the missed opportunity. Olmert, as a prime minister, I was a member of his government, his cabinet. He signed an agreement with Abu Mazen in his home. And Abu Mazen asked for a few days more, and never come. An agreement that Abu Mazen accepted, which means he suggested almost everything possible to suggest. 95% of West Bank, something like 4% of swap, all Gaza Strip, East Jerusalem, and he refused. So we have a problem as in Israelis, because usually when there is a clash between rational people and people who don't take it rationally, you speak to the rational always, not to those who are not. Nobody tried to speak to Daesh today. And matter of fact, I'm sorry to say that I don't understand the world. Daesh is maybe a group of 15, 17,000 people. I think the world was serious about really taking care of Daesh in Syria, which they don't touch them at all. They can really kill their own sources of money. They can, in one or few attacks, they can kill all their sources of money. They're taking oil production from Syria and selling the oil 50% to different countries. That's crazy to leave such an organization to be a threat and to put fear in the hearts of people. They're not that big. But the world is very hesitating to interfere. Yes, you should interfere. There are places in which you cannot stay aside and say we're doing nothing. I think the world should be interfere. And if you're asking me, yesterday Thierry de Montier said that he wants some provocation questions. So I have one. I think that we should making an ice break. Look, we had peace with Egypt, and thanks God that we have that peace since 1979. No soldiers, both sides, no one soldier dead on the borders. We have peace with Jordan, and we live with them very nicely. I wish that we can make peace with Saudi, with Arab Saudi. First, because if Arab Saudi will sign peace with Israel, it will be a big sign that they will be really part, they could be our big bear behind us, Prince Talal. And they could be the one who can call together all the Arab states and move the process, because nobody have any doubt that the solution would be establishing a Palestinian state on side by side with Israel. Yesterday, Prince Talal said, and he's quite right, I believe in it with all my heart, that with the Jewish mind and our money, we can change the world. It's true. When you think about the fact that today in the Middle East, there is purchase of weapon every year in the amount of something like $200 billion. Think what we can do with that money for the benefit of people, for food, for housing, for health, for different places. Israel has a very good economy. We, in Israel at least, we have a good economy. We have a strong army. We're not afraid. We'd never ask anybody to fight for us. But we would like to live peacefully. 75% of the Israeli people and 75% of the Palestinian people are supporting peace and supporting two states to the people, according to the polls done in Israel. The problem is not the people. The problem is leadership. And leadership still, I'm sorry to say, they don't taking decision. I hope, and that's what I'm doing in my life. I push all the time to be in the parties and to push this idea ahead that there will be a government which will make the decision. And I believe, my friend Moratinos, it's not a matter if you negotiate or not. If there is a will, Arafat used to say it all the time. I met with him many times. He always used to say, if there is a will, there is a way. Which means, if somebody will make a decision to make peace, suppose that Netanyahu will answer Abu Mazen, the United Nations, and said, Abu Mazen, ask borders of 67, around 67 borders with a swap, and he wants to have a capital in each part of Jerusalem. Suppose Netanyahu would come up in the United Nations and say, you know what, I accept. Let's make now a decision, and let's discuss the borders. Where will be the borders? Pass here, who cares? Do you really think that any Palestinian care where the border will pass, or any Israeli care really where the border will pass? We would like to be boring state. No news, nothing. Mm. We'd like to live, you know, everybody is tired from us. You're right. Even us, we're tired from ourselves. Jews and Palestinians as well. We would like really to live in peace. In our families, I'm sorry to say, every family in Israel lost their child in wars. So many since Israel was established. We'd like really to live like everybody else in the world, without worrying what's going to happen tomorrow. Today we are always in stress. While you have, apropos, Iran, which I didn't answer before, we cannot allow a situation that Iran will have a nuclear weapon. And I think that Americans should not allow it, not because of Israel. Because if they allow it, it will change the Middle East totally. Iran is a danger to the world. If Iran will have a nuclear weapon and they try to maneuver all the world, if they have a nuclear weapon, it will not be long before you find a nuclear weapon in the hands of terrorists. So think about it. Otherwise, nobody can explain why Iran is developing missiles for 3,000 kilometers, covering all Europe. What for? To Israel, it's much less. You don't need 3,000 kilometers. So we have to take care of it. And I think that the world cannot stay aside and say nothing happening. When Ahmadinejad said in the United Nations said we should wipe Israel off the map. That's crazy. So we have to take him seriously. People say don't take it seriously. Yes, we are taking it seriously. We cannot ignore it. We have to protect our existence and we'll not give up. We are not going to give up ever. Because I believe, we hope, that it will be a diplomatic solution. And you know, diplomatics say that the war is a failure of diplomatic efforts. And I believe that, I believe in diplomatic solution. I wish there will be diplomatic solution.
But I think we understood that.
But we cannot really accept it.
I will give the floor out of democracy to Miguel, who has asked it, and to Hubert.
Well, about not interference, I think, I mean, I understand your point, but I mean, it's how we are going to accept that thousands of civilians are killed. We don't interfere. We don't intervene. I mean, we haven't UN. Lately, there has not been too many good things from UN. But one thing was the responsibility to protect. So sometimes we have to interfere. Yes, you have to interfere if you want to make people survive. And you have to interfere because the parties are asking to interfere to make peace in the Middle East, in the between Palestinian and Israelis. I mean, it depends. We will have a long discussion about interference, of course, bad interference that produce bad results. Nobody wants that. But it could be a good interference, number one. Number two, on the two-state solution, I think, and Iran, we come to the conclusion, everybody agree and everybody will be happy. Mayor, I fully agree with you and with Prince. Why this Arab peace initiative is not implemented? Why you have not been ready to... The best guarantee for the future of Israel is to have a full diplomatic and relation with all Arab world. It's much better that the Americans support and guarantee, I can assure you. So the only thing you have to do is to find a solution with the Palestinians in your way. And we, international community, we have to accompany your final discussion. Everything we know by heart. I know what you told me about Olmert. I know. And I support your position because I know how was the negotiation. So what is needed now is finally to go to this final political decision to negotiate, and can be done. And then you will have a much better reaction instead of fighting terror alone, instead of fighting the coalition alone, you will fight all together. And that will protect the future of the two-state solution in the region.
Thank you. Hubert?
What is the question?
No, I wanted a solution for you. I didn't want a question, I wanted an answer.
Et on what?
No. J'ai cru que tu levais la main tout.
C'est
après.
Sur la démocratie, c'est sur le Proche-Orient, c'est sur quoi?
Au fond, j'ai prolongé ta question sur la meilleure gouvernance. Tu es d'accord ou pas avec le fait que la meilleure gouvernance doit s'appliquer de la même manière dans toutes les parties du monde, parce que les mêmes choses sont demandées par les citoyens où qu'ils vivent, de manière fondamentale.
Quand j'ai parlé de meilleure gouvernance dans l'exposé, d'abord c'est le thème général du forum, de la conférence, et j'en parlais de façon régionale. En fait, c'est l'espérance utopique de voir un jour les différentes puissances du Moyen-Orient s'accorder sur une gestion plus rationnelle et raisonnable des différences et des désaccords. Bon, c'est une utopie. Toi, tu en as parlé sur le plan interne. Et là, je suis d'accord. Tous les peuples du monde aspirent à être mieux gouvernés de façon plus honnête, que les droits de l'homme soient respectés. Mais je ne pense pas que tous les peuples du monde veuillent copier la démocratie occidentale, d'abord parce qu'elle ne marche pas très bien, elle est fatiguée, on le voit à différents signes, le niveau d'abstention, le niveau de contestation au nom de la démocratie directe, et aux États-Unis, l'envahissement par l'argent dans la démocratie, qui est devenu une véritable maladie par rapport à ça. Donc je pense que les peuples partout dans le monde, y compris dans le monde arabe, aspirent à ça, hein, mais ils ne veulent pas que ce soit fait par le biais de l'ingérence. Et je pense que l'ingérence occidentale est au bout du rouleau, en français, hein, au bout du rouleau, en fait. On peut soutenir, on peut encourager, on peut saluer, mais on ne peut pas se substituer au mouvement interne des peuples. Ça, c'est sur les droits de l'homme. Mais quand on revient aux questions dont on a parlé, notamment la question, le blocage sur le Proche-Orient, il est évident qu'on n'aboutira jamais s'il n'y a pas une coalition positive pour aider les Israéliens à sortir du piège. On voit bien d'ailleurs que beaucoup de grandes figures, de grands écrivains, de grands intellectuels israéliens disent « aidez-nous, aidez-nous à sortir du piège ». Et le piège, je l'ai mentionné tout à l'heure, entre autres, c'est le système électoral israélien. C'est impossible en Israël, même s'il y a un camp de la paix virtuelle qui est à la fois courageux, majoritaire, mais qui n'est pas organisé politiquement, qui n'a pas de parti, qui n'a pas de leader, c'est impossible pour un gouvernement quel qu'il soit de prendre des décisions courageuses, parce qu'il a toujours besoin de petits partis nationalistes ou religieux extrémistes. Donc ça ne peut être que d'une coalition des amis d'Israël, à commencer par les États-Unis, qui aideraient les Israéliens qui le souhaitent à sortir du piège. Après, il faudrait gérer une sorte de chaos palestinien qui durerait un certain temps, qu'on a créé volontairement d'ailleurs, mais qui durerait un certain temps. Mais chaque fois qu'on répond à nos questions, on voit qu'on met en avant des objectifs formidables, presque impossibles à atteindre. Bon, il ne faut pas se décourager. Par exemple, dans l'affaire de la... Moi, j'ai trouvé très bien que des assemblées, des parlements en Europe adoptent le texte sur la Palestine. Mais on sait très bien que ça n'a pas de conséquences pratiques. J'ai trouvé très bien que la France parle d'une conférence. Bon, mais il faut un processus. Ça ne peut pas être une conférence comme ça. Alors, on va parler de la conférence avec le futur gouvernement israélien, qui va être encore pire que celui-là. Ça paraît perdu. Sauf si on parle à Israël, sauf si on parle aux gens, à l'opinion. Donc je pense qu'il y a des ressorts qui n'ont pas été assez exploités jusqu'à maintenant. Il y a énormément de personnalités en Israël qui veulent aller dans ce sens. Il y a énormément de gens dans le monde musulman, arabes et musulmans, qui veulent combattre l'extrémisme et le terrorisme, qui veulent combattre l'interprétation folle de l'islam. Donc c'est des forces énormes qui se lèvent et qui sont des leviers qu'il ne faut pas négliger. Il ne faut pas qu'on raisonne uniquement en termes de gouvernement.
Yes, but the negative forces have a passionate will to destroy whatever process.
Yes, but they are not alone.
Whereas the peaceful forces, the moderate forces, are for the moment divided and hesitant. And peace will come as a sacrifice for both parts. And that sacrifice must appear as justified, because clearly the alternative is suicidal, or you have some part of confidence in the fact that the sacrifice you make will be followed by substantial and long-term reward. And for the moment, you have not found the key to unlock that difficult and tangled negative process. We have a little less than 25 minutes, so the debate is open. I see the disturbing factor, Riyad.
J'ai une petite observation, un commentaire et deux questions qui ne sont pas provocantes. L'observation est qu'on a dit, et je crois, que les conflits et les guerres au nom de Dieu ne se terminent jamais, parce que Dieu n'est pas là pour trancher. Ça, c'est la première observation. La deuxième, les questions sont les suivantes à M. Meir. Que pensez-vous du projet d'un État juif dans le, comme condition pour accepter deux États en Palestine et en Israël? Ça, les premières questions. Deuxième question à M. Assad. Vous êtes président d'une association de liberté. Où était la liberté avant 2015 en Syrie, 2011 en Syrie? Merci.
Shall we take another question and then you answer, please?
It was a fascinating discussion on the Middle East, and it was touched upon yesterday and in some of the other panels. But the one place that we simply haven't mentioned, which is a place very close to the part of the world where I come from, which is the Balkans and Southern Europe, is Libya. And that's a place which is in hardly a good shape, and there is an element of responsibility when it comes to international community as to what led to the situation that we have right now in that country, with vast repercussions for stability of wider African region and the greater Middle East. So there is very, very little interest in the face of Fahesh, in the face of the more imminent threats and challenges. But we talked about a number of things that we might try, and the Israeli-Palestinian issue was one, and there is not going to be a deal with Iran. That would be transformational for better or for worse. But this place is in clear need of assistance and support. As I said, there was an element of external responsibility for the situation that we have right now. There was an acquiescence on behalf of those who have not intervened directly. I'm referring to Russia. So we're all kind of responsible as a family of nation for this situation there. Is there anything that can be done? And whose leadership could it be this time? Not from behind, but from the front.
So, Meir, Ribal, and Miguel.
Yeah. All right. About two stated to people, I said, I think all what I said in this panel was that I'm supporting it with all my heart, and I'm not the only one. And, you know, sometimes when people ask what we can do that we haven't done, I'm going to say something provocative maybe, but maybe time has arrived that the United States would really to be involved in solution of the situation. Maybe they should force an agreement on both sides. Maybe the agreements, the sides cannot negotiate and come to an agreement. And maybe they can make their own plan, come with it, and force Israel and the Palestinians say, that's the agreement, you have to accept it. It could be a good excuse to both sides to say we have no choice, neither the Israelis or the Palestinians. But in a better way, I believe that they could at least do something more constructive, call all the Arab League countries to Washington with the Palestinians and with the Israelis, and put them together in Camp David or whatever needed until they come to conclusion. That will change the world. And I think that the only way to do it is really through the Arab Initiative. Now, why no one? Why did you ask why no one pick it up? And I'm telling you now, I'm discovering it. I spent hours with every prime minister since 2002, tried to convince them to go that way and to call Riyadh and said, we accept the initiative as a basis, let's talk about it. And I'm sorry to say, I failed. I sit with every prime minister since 2002, everyone. And I know them personally, some of them I have been minister in their governments, with some not, but I have a good relationship with each individual, including Netanyahu. And I try to put every element to explain why and have failed. Well, I answer myself, why? Why I'm failing? Why cannot they see what I'm seeing? My answer is that, in my opinion, the Israeli administration, the Israeli prime ministers would like very much first to satisfy the American administration. And therefore, they prefer to go to that direction, to bilateral negotiation, moderated by Americans. And I said, it's a big mistake. As I said before, Americans are not the ones who can solve the problem by negotiation. It's not the way. Maybe they can do it by forcing it. In 1956, when Israel, together with France and England, occupied all Sinai, President of the United States gave an order to Israel to get out of there, of Ben-Gurion at that time. It took a few days and we were out. So I think maybe they cannot overcome, as my friend said before. Maybe because of the situation, political situation in Israel, as far as we don't have a central left government, maybe we cannot overcome the political difficulties in Israel and make a decision, even if there will be prime minister which will agree to go that way. So maybe time will come, maybe, to really to force it, to come with agreement that will be done on a bona fide by the Americans trying to take in consideration the both sides and make an agreement, say that's the way you should go, and have the accept, have the agreement of Russia and China and Europe, and come, if all the world come to those guys, and guys, you are drunk, they will have to go to sleep.
Thank you. Ribat.
Yes, thank you very much, Mr. Riad. But I didn't really understand. I mean, you questioned, because we all know that there was no democracy and freedom in Syria, and that's why the reason that the people of Syria has risen against the government, actually. But their demands at the beginning, we all understand that they were for freedom and genuine democracy and not something that, you know, not to exchange the dictatorship for a theocracy. Unfortunately, a lot of people, again, in the region did not want genuine democracy to go on in Syria, because that would threaten their own countries, and have funded, you know, and sent groups who do not, you know, who do certainly not want to see any democracies in the Middle East, and certainly not in Syria. We have suffered, myself personally, my family, we have suffered a lot from the regime, even though they're our family, so I could imagine how the Syrian people have suffered also. But that doesn't mean that we have to react with grudges. It's not, you cannot build democracy and freedom based on grudges. We have to be able to build for a country like Syria and Lebanon, as you are yourself from Lebanon. We are a beautiful mosaic of people in these countries. And the only way to protect this beautiful mosaic is to have a genuine democracy. Mr. Hubert Védrine said earlier that democracies in the Middle East cannot, you know, in Europe cannot be maybe replicated in the Middle East. Well, maybe, but it needs a process. The process needs to start somewhere. We cannot, it's something that has to be transitional. Nobody said that you're going to get it tomorrow. It has to be transitional, peaceful. If it doesn't get, it's certainly not going to be built over the bodies of 200,000 people who have died. And by the way, 200,000, yes, they were died because the regime, I mean, because of the regime was responsible, but not because the regime killed them. 80,000% of them were killed by the Islamists and the rebels and others who, you know, but and they are part of the security forces and the military. So we cannot just, they are not only black and white here, you know, there's
you said,
you know, we
I'm
have,
sorry, you said 18 or
80? 80,000 are members actually of the security forces and the military. And, you know, minorities have suffered a lot. So what about those minorities who also wanted, does anyone believe that minorities in Syria don't want democracy? Does anyone believe that a Christian or an Alawite or a Druze or a Shia or a Kurds doesn't want a genuine democracy in Syria? Of course they do. But they do not want to see, as you know, His Royal Highness said yesterday, there are video on YouTube and other social media, and people are seeing what's going on, are seeing that our people are killing Christian people, they are killing Alawites, they are killing other minorities just to belong for a certain sect or religion. They are killing Kurds, they are killing whoever does not share their perverted ideology. And this is the big problem. And this is why we cannot let it's like I always say the same thing. We cannot let, if your two children are fighting, you cannot leave them in a room and tell them, well, guys, resolve your issues and I'll come back an hour later to, you know, and see how it goes, because they're going to kill each other. And this is the same thing. People in the Middle East are not ready. They have no experience. It took Europe, it took the West hundreds of years to get to the democracy where we are today. You know, so it's going to take also the Middle East a lot longer. But we have been there. The West has been there. There has been also sectarian wars. So we know how to help them so that they don't have to go down that road. We have to help them through education, investing a lot into education. Because on the other side, there's another torrent that's investing in Islamic extremism, and they are spending a lot of money. What are we doing to counter that? There are billions of dollars on satellite TVs, on internet websites, on social media, and others. You know, just a month ago, the information minister of Saudi Arabia, Minister Khoja, issued a decree to close down a satellite TV that is based in Saudi Arabia and that incites hatred, killing, and violence against minorities. You know, and unfortunately, the next day he was sacked, and the TV was reopened again. This shows again that there is also a problem in Saudi Arabia. You know, the king, we all know, you know, and we have, you know, between my father and, I mean, there's an old friendship which His Royal Highness knows very well, between him and the king, and we trust in the king. But unfortunately, Saudi Arabia, when we talk about the kingdom, is also not one current. There are currents in Saudi Arabia, like many other countries. Some want to go forward. Some want to fight extremism. Some want to put those ISIS, al-Nusra, as a Muslim Brotherhood on the list of terrorism. But on the other hand, there is a very strong current who is stopping that. And this is why we have to come together. And as I mean, when I talk I was raised in the West. I was raised in France. I was, I've studied in the U.S. I've studied in the U.K. I live, I've been living since I was 9 years old abroad. So I consider myself as a citizen of the world and not just as a Syrian. As we have to come together and help the people, and we owe it to them because they look up to us. When they are looking for, when they went into the streets and asked for democracies and freedom, they were looking up to us. They were looking west. They were looking on the lives that we have. And this is what was their example. And we can only do that if we come together, if we leave our differences aside. I mean, with China, Russia, the problems that they have with the U.S. and Europe. And we have to put our differences aside. Why? Because we all share one common enemy. There was fascism and Nazism at one time. Today we have Islamism. And if we don't come together to defeat it, it is threatening each one of our countries. You know, Europe today is saying, after 4 years, they are saying now again that there is, all those foreign fighters that are going to Syria are becoming the greatest threat to their national security. You know, but also there are conflicting reports. The European are saying there are 3,000 fighters, Western fighters, that went into Syria. Eric Holder from the U.S. said there are 7,000 Western fighters. There's a big gap between both. 7,000, it's very dangerous. Those people, once they go get trained and they get, Islamicized and they come back to Europe, what are we going to do about them? How could you stop them? You know, first of all, you shouldn't have allowed them to go there. But now, how are we able to stop those extremists going there? And you read other reports saying that the extremists, the foreign extremists, not Western, the foreign extremist number in general is 15,000. How could they be 7,000 from the West and another 8,000 from all other Islamic countries? This does not make sense. The number must be 10 times higher because of lack of education, because of poverty, because of all of that. You know, if there are 7,000 from the West, there are certainly 70,000 from other countries. Thank you very much.
Miguel?
Yes, Libya is a proof of what Dominique Moïsis said at the beginning, no? The extension of the geography of the Middle East. Of course, Libya could become a new Afghanistan. And is the perfect, explanation of my intellectual debate and political debate about good interference and lack of involvement. I mean, in Libya, unfortunately, has been a lot of bad interference and no post-conflict follow-up after the decision really to change regime in Libya. And today, has been just in Tunisia recently, the Prime Minister was telling me very clearly that what they need is, first, no interference sending arms and weaponry to both sides, and involvement in order to promote dialogue between the two sides. So either we take it seriously and we help the involvement of UN, my compatriot Bernardino Neon and others that are trying to help, or we Europeans, all the region, but we Europeans, we will have in front of us a new Afghanistan. So it should be taken extremely serious.
Thank you. We have time for another last round of questions.
Thank you, Mr. President.
I'm just the chair.
Okay, chair. Okay, Mr. Chair. Minister Vedran, Minister Shetrit, and Mr. Assad spoke, all of them, about Turkey. And therefore, I would like to underline some points. First of all, we have the common responsibility to reverse the tide of extremism, sectarianism, terrorism, and so on. And the saying of our prophet is, Efşu selame beynekum, shalom, peace, selam, peace, spread selam among you.
Selam aleykum.
Now, in this case, we should avoid the misuse of religion in the Middle East, especially Daesh and the others. Concerning the Turkish policy towards the Daesh, Turkey shares 1,295 kilometers borders with Syria and Iraq. It is not easy case. Any threat emanating from this geography has serious adverse effects on Turkey. After the Syria crisis started, Daesh acts added more fuel to this, to the fire. This is one point. The other one, the Kobani case. We are fighting against the terror organization PKK since 1984. This is recognized also internationally as a terror organization. Now, it is not logical to expect from Turkey to change its policy by 180 degrees. It is very difficult. But Turkey, on the one side. On the other side, we have more than 2 million. The official figures are 1,500,000 refugees in Turkey. And the spent amount is more than, until now, $5 billion. This is a big problem, and therefore, air operations against Daesh should continue, but it is not enough. Air strikes solo cannot eradicate extremism. This is right. There is a need for a more holistic and comprehensive strategy addressing the root causes. And a part of the international coalition against Daesh, Turkey has been emphasizing every time that the success is a wished result. Turkey is wishing a success in that direction. But Daesh has been effective thanks to the air support it receives from different parts. This is a big problem. Now, concerning the free zone dispute, of course, Syria is not supporting. But Turkey is not supported by better understanding of the terror organization. And the problem is a little bit complicated. And therefore, we should sit down and negotiate further. Thank you very much.
So the last point. Yes.
Oui, juste une question. Il y a un sujet que vous n'avez absolument pas abordé et qui pourtant me semble être au cœur, non pas du problème israélo-palestinien, mais du problème de l'ensemble du Moyen-Orient, qui est celui du pétrole. Peut-être parce que s'il y a mauvaise gouvernance, c'est largement lié à l'argent du pétrole. Et je voudrais quand même avoir votre réaction face à ce qui est en train de se passer. Quelles vont être, à votre sens, les conséquences du contre-choc pétrolier, largement instrumentalisé, me semble-t-il, par l'Arabie saoudite, je l'imagine avec la bénédiction des États-Unis, sur un certain nombre de pays?
Alors, dernière question, et en fait, on n'a plus de temps. J'interromprai très vite ce débat. Vous n'avez plus de micro, même. On ne veut plus. Vous êtes puni.
Thank you very much.
Be as quick as possible.
It's just from the perspective of Morocco, what's happening in the region has serious consequences. And one of the consequences, and I would love to have the comments of the panel on that, is that the attractivity of political Islam that we had, and let's say take the Turkish model, was very attractive within the region. is not anymore very, very much so attractive. And this has changed as a roller coaster. I mean, you know, you take 2010 and you take 4 years later. This is a complete change and a sort of normalization of Turkey in terms of projecting an attractive model for, you know, let's say, political Islam or countries that are Muslim countries. And I would like to have your take on that. And this is a good news, basically, from my point of view, but you know, not necessarily for everybody.
I'm afraid, as the representative of the organization, we'll have to close. I will make two quick comments, moving away from my role of moderator. On the issue of Turkey, the comment from Morocco is very interesting. I have been amongst those in Europe advocating as early as the 1980s for the entrance of Turkey in the European Union. So I can't be suspicious. You can't blame me, but I don't recognize the Turkey I was supporting 30 years ago. And you have to ask yourself why those who were so much for Turkey have growing doubts about the cause they were supporting. On the issue of oil, you just have to look at the last cover of The Economist, Shakes versus Shale. And the answer that is given is not the one you are suggesting. There is tension between Saudi Arabia and the United States on that issue, an element of objective rivalries which pushes the price of oil down, which not necessarily is a good news either for Russia or Venezuela, among others. And we have to close there. I want to thank you very much all for this very lively debate. I'm not sure we are much closer to the cause of global peace in the Middle East, but I just hope we are not further away after the debate. Thank you very much.